Some viewers may find the following video disturbing. Viewer discretion is advised.
The Kawasaki Dream, which has become better known as the King of the Deathmatch Tournament, was held on August 18th of 1995. I was now set to face the Funker in a no-rope barbed wire match that had the addition of C4 explosives rigged onto barbed wire boards inside the ring. Oh yeah, and at the 10-minute mark, the ring was going to blow up. When I went into the ring, I was scared but filled with a feeling of power that was not unlike my feeling of being on top of the scaffold in Fort Worth 6 years earlier. Some of the fans were chanting "Cock too soft." Most of them were physically and mentally worn down from hours of sunshine and bloodshed. The Funker arrived in the ring to his decades-old theme music and chants of "Tally, Tally." He looked old and worn out. Hell, he was old and worn out.
Cactus Jack.
The bell rang and we stalked each other like Rocky and Apollo Creed in the last round of the original Rocky. Terry flicked out a couple of jabs that grazed my eye and opened the gas slightly. It was tough to get a rhythm going. Barbed wire matches were tough enough, even without the added presence of boards laced with explosives in every corner. We tried to use the wire and we tried to do some moves. We fought outside and used the non-explosive boards. I even hit Terry with a half-used spool of barbed wire. We rolled back into the ring and Terry pulled one of the boards into the middle of the ring. Kawasaki Stadium started to buzz. This is what they had come to see. With the ominous board in the center of the ring, we picked up the pace. Punch for punch we went, and then I took over. Wham! A forearm staggered the grizzled veteran. Wham! Another one had him reeling. Terry was positioned directly in front of the board and was about to go down. Four more forearms to the head, and the Funker finally fell like a tree onto the explosives below. Ba-boom! Oh!
Yeah.
I brought Terry to the wire strands on his hands and knees. I draped him over and then took two steps back. Came with an elbow, but Terry moved out of the way and I landed awkwardly on the wire with my back and triceps taking the brunt of the barbs. Terry picked me up and shot me into the wire. As I got closer, I became braver to the point that I thought, I'm going to take this whole side out. I'd done this twice at Corrigan Hall, and it was impressive, but injuries were likely. I didn't really care at this point. I was pretty banged up already. As it turned out, the point was moot. The wire was strung so well that my entire body barely even made it sag. Oh, it ripped me up all right. It just didn't look that good. The move bought Terry some time, however, and when I got up, another explosive board was in center ring, and Terry was waiting with a hip toss. Ba-boom! Ooh-ah! Wait, what's this, I thought. I'm not even really hurt. Apparently, I'd been rolling with the hip toss, and in the split second between impact and detonation, I had narrowly avoided most of the explosion. I was victorious in my first match with Terry Gordy, even after suffering a powerbomb on 10,000 thumbtacks, and defeated Shoji Nakamaki in the semifinal. When I landed at JFK the next day, my dad was there to pick me up. I shook his hand and he guessed correctly that the previous evening had been a rough one. I deliberately kept my right arm, which was now a crusty brown from the previous night's explosion, away from him. I stepped into our rented house in Long Island and was met by a big reaction of, Daddy, Daddy, Daddy. Colette gave me a hug and quickly said, What's burning? I played dumb, but Colette persisted. God, Mick, that's bad. Was someone smoking next to you on the plane? By this time, I was twisting into some strange positions to keep my wife, children, and father from seeing my arm. My dad said goodbye, and when he stepped out the door, Colette was on me again. Can't you smell something burning, Mick? It's awful. I finally answered, Yes, I do, Colette. As I turned my right arm to my wife, it's me. The next few months in 1995 seemed to blend together professionally. I feuded with the Funker in the U.S. and I feuded with the Funker overseas. The trips were long and the amenities stank, but I was selling my shirts and getting over with the fans. And the boredom of life so far from home was a price I had to pay. I read a hell of a lot over there and became better acquainted with my body, if you know what I mean. My hard work was paying off. I had been gone from WCW for almost a year, and although I hadn't made nearly as much money as I had with the big company, I had actually saved more of it. I didn't need anybody, and I could make my own schedule, and I loved it.
Oh!
I had come back and had Terry entangled in the wire in a bad way at the 9-minute mark. We had 1 minute until the ring was set to explode. My heart was racing as we faced the moment of truth. Finally, when the announcer started his 10-second countdown, I slid underneath the wire to watch this tremendous spectacle from outside the ring. 8, 7, 6. Terry tried to stand but fell back down. The fans were screaming his name. 5, 4, 3. And yes, they do count in English in Japan. I don't know why. No matter what happened or how long it took, I was going to have Terry kick out of my pin attempt. He would be known forever as the guy who kicked out of the ring explosion. 2, 1. The four explosions that went off looked like Roman candles. I felt the whole match slipping away. Terry just stood up with his arms out to his side as if to say, hey, it's not my fault. I tried my best to think of a way to save the match and came up with only one solution. Injuries were about to pile up. I stepped inside the ring. I put on a sloppy headlock that was really just a setup. He lifted me slowly in the air and dropped me backward on the remaining explosive board. Ba-boom! The third sound was me screaming. I had landed in such a way that the damn explosives had gone off directly underneath my arm. I felt like I'd been shot. I should have stayed down forever, but I was so hurt and scared that I popped right up. Terry stayed down. A portion of the explosion had caught under his right triceps, and he was in considerable pain. I crawled to the outside and looked under the ring for something to play with. I saw a toolbox and a stretcher, but pulled out a ladder instead. I rolled into the ring and shouldered the ladder lengthwise. As Terry turned, I charged him, and the impact of his head was so severe that I felt somewhat guilty. I got over it. Set up the ladder to the side of the fallen Funker. He was too close to land on, so I gave him a boot that moved him over. I ascended to the fifth step, about 6 feet in the air. The blood was really flowing from a cut in my hairline. It was so thick that it resembled more of a solid mask than a liquid. I stepped from the ladder and got the perfect elbow on Terry. Terry was really hurting now. As I rolled off him, I could see the anguish in his eyes. I tried to talk to him, but his mumbling was incoherent. I climbed the ladder again, but as I approached the fifth step, Terry got up and fell into the ladder. I felt like the guy in the old F Troop Ford as I felt the ladder tipping. I fell into the barbed wire and the consequences were steep. I opened up an angry gash in my right hand and a huge gash that almost cost me my good ear. It took me quite a while to get up, and when I did, Terry still wasn't moving. He was down on his back again and was obviously too hurt to continue. I crawled over and draped my arm over him for a somewhat anticlimactic victory. The audience was confused but not disappointed. I had wrestled way too long and hard that day for my victory to be questioned. I was the king of the deathmatch.